Welcome back, guys, to another episode of Bowhunt or Die. Now that Justin and I have solved all the world's problems before starting the show, we are officially ready to get this episode off the ground. No, Justin, I'm not going to go to any construction sites after filming this show today, but I will tell you, if I go bike riding or I'm out on a jog, this t-shirt here is going to keep me safe.
Everyone is going to know.
Everyone knows what deer stands we use for sure.
Tree stand from here moving forward. So guys, you know, before we jump into the hunting action we've got for this week, you know, we have some exciting news here at Bowhunting.com. You know, for those of you who have been on the website, you've probably seen some banner ads and some logos start to show up. But you know, we are super excited to announce that, you know, we have partnered with the folks over at Lancaster Archery. You know, as our official partner of the provider of archery and bow hunting gear, whether it be online or via their catalog or via their store that they have out in Pennsylvania. And the reason that that's exciting for us is it presents some great new opportunities, you know, for our team and for all of our viewers to, you know, take advantage of some of the expertise that Lancaster has in the archery world and just the sheer vast quantity of products that they sell. I think, you know, you're going to see in the video here, Rob says 45,000 products they carry.
Yeah, and Justin, we were lucky enough to have Rob come and visit us when we were doing our Bowhunt or Die staff meetings, and just having him here and having him see our operation, of course, visiting his as well, just sure. Gives you a different appreciation for all the hard work that those guys put into making sure that you, the hunter or the target archer, has all of that knowledge and all that gear available right at your fingertips with a simple phone call.
Yeah, so with that being said, we are going to jump into a little video here with Todd and Rob Kofeld, who is the owner of Lancaster Archery, talking a little bit more about their business.
Well, Rob, I'm glad you were able to get down here to my facility and see my place. You were gracious enough to invite me up to yours, and I don't know that my place, I think I'd rather spend more time in your facility because there's a lot more stuff that I want to fill my car with and take home, but I'm glad you were able to come down and meet us here. As you may or may not know, guys, Rob is the owner of Lancaster Archery. They run an absolute premier archery shop in Pennsylvania, and they have probably one of the greatest catalogs for archers and bow hunters. Rob, want to tell me a little bit of how you got started?
Well, I've been a longtime fan of Bowhunt or Die and you and your operation and what your team does. But 34 years ago, just like any other pro shop owner, started out and always with a passion for both bow hunting and for competitive and target archery. And archery's blessed us in many, many ways. A lot of great people in it, as you know. And from the store, we started to distribute to dealers and government agencies all over the country. And started the website in 96, the catalog in 91.
Well, you know, actually going and visiting your facility, I mean, you have, beyond the showroom, of course, I mean, for the people who are lucky enough to live close by, and as you mentioned to me, you know, people even come from multiple states just to spend the whole day at your facility. You also have multiple shooting ranges. Right. Tell us more about those opportunities if people do want to come by and see you.
Well, the Lancaster Archery Academy, we've got people that'll come from 5 and 6 hours away to get professional coaching, go to a workshop or a clinic. We have coaches certification, judges certification, things like that for all during the year. Each quarter we have certified training and whatnot. We've got 4 large indoor ranges, total of 55 lanes, got outdoor ranges, hold tournaments and events.
Well, I can tell you from, you know, firsthand visiting the place, I mean, it was definitely somewhere where if I lived nearby, I would definitely spend some time at. If you're a couple states away, you know what, make the road trip, grab some guys and hang out there. Now, you know, this is the catalog for 2016. If you'd like to get your own personalized catalog, I mean, you can go to the website, of course, and sign up for one. How many products do we actually, you know, have in inventory?
45,000 items. Archery core items from over 600 manufacturers.
Well, and again, guys, you know, this is kind of, this is unique, because I mean, they call this their archery wish book, and I got to tell you, it definitely is a wish book. I mean, I was flipping through it and marking some pages. One of the neat things about doing business with Lancaster, of course, too, is a lot of the products that Justin and I use here in the show are available directly through, you know, Rob's business. Rob, what other kind of things do we want to let the people know? I know you got a great shoot that you put on every single year. I have not been to that shoot this year, but luckily enough, 2017, me and a few of the crew members are definitely going to be there.
Looking forward to having you. End of January, it's January 27th to 29th, the Lancaster Archery Classic Tournament. There's a lot of YouTube coverage of what the event is like for those of you that want to look it up. People will be shooting for about $145,000 in cash and prizes that weekend.
And these aren't just for pros, right? I mean, this is for anybody.
Correct. We have youth classes. We have master classes for people 50 and up, like me.
Okay.
So there'd be a great time. About 35 different manufacturers will be there, so there's a trade show as well.
Well, I definitely appreciate you being able to get here, Rob. And one of the things that you will be able to look forward to in some of the upcoming episodes is we're going to be doing tech tips, you know, how to make your bow shoot better, all different kinds of little things, some of them that are going to be put on by Justin and I, and then, of course, some of your team members are going to be putting on those tech tips as well. So,
yep, we're looking forward to working with the Bowhunter Die crew for sure.
Thanks again to Rob for taking the time to stop by the studio and film that video with us. And, you know, one other thing I just did want to mention about Lancaster that kind of makes them different from some of the other online retailers out there. You know, not only the quantity of products that they have available, but the fact that they have expert staff standing by to help people when you have a question. And that's really what differentiates them from, you know, some of the other kind of fly-by-night websites sure. that are out there. I mean, if you guys have a question about tuning your bow, what product's going to work the best, what product is going to fit, they have people standing by that you can call or email for help and tech support. You know, that's a great thing that they have over there. And, you know, one last thing we wanted to mention, guys, if you want to buy gear from Lancaster Archery, you can actually go to bowhunting.com, click on the shop menu, and there's a drop-down window that's going to come down. It's going to have links to all their most popular categories, bows, sights, arrows, anything you guys can need for bow hunting. Lancaster has it in stock, so make sure you check it out. Now, Todd, with that out of the way, you get to introduce a brand new team member.
Yes,
everybody.
We do. We have a brand new team member from Austin, Texas. And I'll tell you what, man, after seeing this footage come in, I mean, Justin, the other teammates are going to be watching the show going, man, this Tyler kid, he's ready to rock it out. That's for sure. And of course, guys, one of the things that we're always trying to do here is reach out to other areas. I mean, is this our first spring hog hunt that we've had?
First hog hunt ever.
First hog hunt ever. I don't know about ever, but I do know for sure this is our first spring Texas hunt from a guy that's going to be bringing us footage from a whole different area. I'm excited.
So let's check it out now. We got a great hog hunt from Texas with Tyler Barron.
Here in Central Texas. I'm on my very first bow hunt for the Bowhunter Die crew and my very first hunt of 2016. It's May the 25th, about 90 degrees, super windy, and not really the greatest hunting conditions. I'm up here sweating my butt off right now, but I'm gonna see if I can do a little bit of property management and hunting at the same time and take out some of the feral hogs that are moved in on this property and are kind of destroying the property that we hunt on during the fall. So with a little luck, I'll get one down on the ground and hopefully I'll have something here for you guys soon. Bow hunter die. Very first pig of the 2016 season. Couldn't be more excited. Came in perfectly, just exactly how I wanted to. I don't even know where he came from. He just suddenly popped up there, but perfect 20-yard shot. I'm pretty sure I just double-lunged him with the Spitfire, so I'm hoping that he didn't go very far. I heard him crash around just a second ago, so I don't know. I hope he's down, but I'm so excited. This is why I do it. Bow hunt or die, baby. I'm going to try and film my recovery here of the hog that I just shot a little while ago. So I gave him a little bit of time and went down here and just kind of started walking around where the point of impact was, and made it about 10 yards before I found my first blood. So I'm going to see if I can maybe track down where he went from there and kind of see if we can get this hog recovered. So stay tuned. Okay, so I'm about 40 yards into my track right now, and he ran into some of the thickest stuff on the whole place. So I'm going to see if I can dive back in here. I probably won't be able to film much while I'm crawling through the woods, but I'm going to see if I can recover him here pretty quick. Mosquitoes are about to eat me alive, as you can probably see in the video. So with a little luck, he won't be too far in here, and I'll drag him out and see if we can get some trophy photos. Okay, so I'm probably 60 to 80 yards into the track, and I just found my arrow, so I want to show you guys what that looks like real quick. Have an amazing blood trail to work with here, so only thing that's making it difficult is how thick these woods are. I'll give you kind of just a quick glimpse around me. I'm on my knees right now, and it's just solid brush in every single angle all around me, so that's what I'm crawling through, but totally worth it at the end of the day when you see something like this. All right, guys, so here he is. Here's my first hog kill of 2016, hopefully the first of many. And finally got him into a little clearing here. This guy ran into some of the thickest brush on our entire property, so it was definitely a fight to get him out of here, and fortunately I didn't have to track him too far. He maybe made it 60, 80 yards tops. This Spitfire really did a number on him, and he dropped down pretty quick. So didn't get a full pass through as I would expect with a big hog like this. This guy's probably pushing 275, maybe 300 pounds. So it was definitely a fight to get him into this clearing, and it's gonna be a fight to get him out the rest of the way. So couldn't be more happy about this entire hunt, and I'm looking forward to getting as many of these kind of taken off of this property as possible. They're nothing but invasive species who really hurt the native populations of deer and other wildlife. So definitely happy to get this guy off the ground and into the freezer, hopefully. So stay tuned for hopefully some more hunting here this spring and into the summer, and then hopefully the fall is going to be a great one. So I spooked a couple of deer on the way in, and it's nice seeing some velvet running through the trees there, even just for a couple of seconds. So bow hunt or die, guys. I'll see you soon.
You know, Justin, watching that hunt, I mean, I know it's not a buck standing there, but I'll tell you what, it's about the closest thing after seeing all these turkey hunts that we've been having. It's finally good to see a four-legged creature down there on the ground, and I mean, puts a great shot on it.
Yep.
What are you laughing at over here? What's that?
I just enjoy your commentary. I think it's funny sometimes.
Hey, it's better than watching these turkeys. I mean, I like turkey hunting.
And by the way, we have two turkey hunts coming up, everybody. Don't get too excited.
Hey, all I'm saying is that it's nice to know that we are months away from being able to grab a bow and go deer hunting.
Sure.
That's all I'm saying.
No, Tom and I were talking about that on my ride into work this morning. I mean, we're just kind of going over future episodes we have coming up, and there's like 4 or 5 episodes left before we get into like the first out west, you know, August antelope hunts, which is pretty amazing to me. But, you know, congratulations to Tyler. He did a great job on that hunt. Very solid, well filmed, you know, good on camera. You know, we're super excited to have him on the team to bring some of that southern flair. Us Midwest boys, we get a little bit old sometimes, everybody watching us, so it's nice to have
Speak
somebody.
For yourself, getting old, man. Todd's twice today.
Todd's got contacts now, in case didn't notice. He's trying to look more youthful. Trying to look more youthful for everybody. Maintain his celebrity persona.
I've actually had these contacts for over a year now, and I lost my glasses. I cannot find my glasses anywhere, so I stuck them in my eyes the last couple days.
You look good. We like the new Todd. Post-goggles Todd, maybe. So, you know, congrats again to Tyler. Next up, guys, we have two more exciting turkey hunts from John Herrmann up in Wisconsin. You know, we've already seen Johnny twice out in Wyoming and Wisconsin as well, but he had some more tags, and he definitely filled them. So let's check these hunts out now.
Hey everybody, it is, what day is it, Wednesday, May 11th, so this will be the start of Wisconsin's 5th turkey season. There's 6 turkey seasons in Wisconsin, so we've got One more starting next Wednesday, but I've got tags for this week and next week. However, because Wisconsin had such an early spring, we had 80 degree temperatures back in early March, which kind of got everything melted off and got spring started way early. So what's going on here is the turkeys started everything early. And so this is really, really late for turkey hunting right now. They're getting more and more into just feeding and less into the breeding. So they've been really quiet. They're not really responding to any calls. They're blind shy, decoy shy. You know, it's not real turkey hunting right now. It's more of a patterning, trying to find out where they're roosted, where they're feeding, and getting in between them and kind of shutting up and hoping they'll come with, you know, close enough to your blind to get a shot. So luckily I've got two turkeys under my belt already this year, so it's not like it's any big deal, but I would like to shoot another bird, so I'm gonna hunt a few mornings and see if I can't luck into one. First report of the morning at 6 a.m. We've been light out here for about 20 minutes. Have not heard one gobble. Haven't heard any hen talk. Nothing happening out here. Absolutely perfect morning. I don't know if I don't have any turkeys around me or if they're just not talking, but we got all day, so we're just gonna stay patient. Well, that's not exactly what I wanted to have happen. I would have preferred that to be a big old long beard. But there's a bunch of jakes on this property, and it's getting really tough out here. And I said to myself, if those jakes come in and give me a perfect setup, I may take them. And I drew back on them the first time they came through, and they just never stopped, and I just was having doubts on whether or not I wanted to shoot one or not. And when they came back through, they just milled over to the left of me here, and then they kind of fed their way back through, and that one just made the mistake of kind of stopping in my sweet spot for too long, and so put the hurt to him. It looked like a really good shot. The arrow stayed in it. He just ran up over the hill. So I'm gonna go out there and try to retrieve him, and we'll see what he looks like. I've actually never shot a jake before, so I don't know really what I'm feeling right now. I feel good. It's nice to get a bird. Well, here he is. He is definitely not the biggest Tom in this neck of the woods, but he was the biggest Jake out of those seven. You know, I was debating on whether or not to shoot him, and he just paused at the wrong time in one of my sweet spots, and I decided to put the hurt to him, made a really nice shot on him. It's been a good morning. It's been a really good season. I've actually shot three birds now, one out in Wyoming and two here in Wisconsin. And I've got one more tag left for week six. I don't really know how much hunting I'm gonna do. It's been such early spring up here in Wisconsin that even though it's fifth week and 6 week next week, it's correlating to a much later time, and these turkeys are really not into the breeding mode anymore. They're mostly into a feeding mode, and it takes away a little bit of the excitement of the hunt because you don't get the gobbling going on and the strutting. So I don't know how much hunting I'm going to do next week, but if I don't do any, I've still had a great start to my season. Hopefully this might be one of those years where I shoot three toms in the spring and whack a couple big bucks in the fall. So more turkey hunting's coming your way. Stay tuned. Bowhunter die, guys. Well, the first light report is it's chilly out here. I actually have heard a couple of gobbles, but they've been quite a ways away. I haven't really been able to place them. I'm pretty sure one of them is west of me, and one of them is northeast of me, but I don't know that for sure. Red light district. So it's 4:30 a.m. It's May 20th. I'm up in west central Wisconsin, Chippewa County, and I am looking for my fourth turkey of the year. We've got 3 days, no, 4 days left of Wisconsin's turkey season. It's the last season, sixth season. Oh wow, that was a perfect morning, absolutely perfect morning. I had two toms to the north of me, a bunch of jakes, had a hen that was, I don't know if she was even with them. But anyways, I was talking back and forth with her and had the decoy out here to the south of me. You know, so if anything came off of that finger ridge, it was gonna, you know, pull them right into my sweet spot. And I mean, you couldn't have drawn it up any better than that. I had the two toms leading the pack. I mean, they just came right up to me, 15 yards. He's strutting for the decoy. I mean, came right into my sweet spot. I got all kinds of stealth cam on video pointing right there. And I just rushed it. I mean, I just rushed it. I tell you what, it's been a pretty tough year for me and shooting stuff. And it's just, I got a pretty bad case of target panic going on. I've kind of always had it, but man, I just cannot put the pin where it's supposed to be before I pull the trigger. I'm not going to shoot him walking. That bird was walking again, so it's just not good. I'm going to really work on it this summer and try to get rid of that target panic. I got to be able to put a pin where it's supposed to be before I pull the trigger, so I am going to officially shut it down for my 2016 turkey season. Well, kids, this is one happy sight right here. I just started looking for him about 20 minutes ago. He must have dropped dead right out of the air. The last I saw him was about 75 yards straight east of me here. And I just started gridding stuff out, and I was just going to walk all this ground and just make sure that he wasn't laying dead somewhere. And there he is right there. So anyways, I got that bird back here, and I was kind of just out of it with, thinking I had lost him and then got him. I filmed all my interviews with the bird and the fan and everything in front of me, and I didn't have any of it in focus, so go figure. So I'm just recapping my hunt a little bit for you, and so that you guys can actually see me while I'm talking rather than just a blur. But all in all, it's been a great turkey season. Sure I had some issues, but I'm gonna work on them this summer. And hopefully this good turkey season that I had is going to translate into a great deer season. And hopefully I can show you guys me shooting a couple of big bucks this fall. So stay tuned. There's more to come from Johnny Herrmann this year.
Man, John Herrmann is on fire this year. I mean, Justin, four turkeys. How many trio cameras did he have set up? I mean, I counted at least four or five in that one.
Yeah, I think he told
setting.
Me eight at one point in time. I don't know if it was that hunt or a different hunt, but he is definitely going for the record of most stealth cams set up around his turkey blind.
Watching that turkey get shot and then go running right towards the camera. I mean, that was a great shot. He's definitely going to get some awards for that for sure. But I mean, what an incredible year. I mean, four turkeys. Well filmed by himself. I mean, those are awesome hunts.
Sure, and the one thing we should mention, is Johnny talks a little bit about it in his interview, but the fact that he's struggling with a little bit of target panic, and I know that's happened to almost every bow hunter or archer I know, whether you realize it or not, it is a real thing. And, there's a lot of stuff you could do during the off season to try to overcome that target panic. If you guys go onto the bowhunting.com forums or just go onto bowhunting.com and search for target panic, you'll find all the various different symptoms of it. Usually it's guys, punching the trigger the minute that pin gets anywhere near where you want it to go. And that's usually one of the biggest causes for, making a bad shot. Luckily, Johnny was able to recover that, fourth turkey that he ended up harvesting. But, I mean, it is a real deal. We all struggle with it. Now is the time you want to try to take care of some of that stuff during the off season, before we get into fall.
I'll never forget, Justin. I'll go ahead and just tell the story real quick.
Okay.
I'll never forget this. I mean, I think I was in college. And I was going back to full draw, and bam, I hit my trigger and punched myself in the face. Have you ever done that before?
Yeah.
Come on.
It has nothing to do with target panic.
I know, but it was a bloody nose, the whole deal. And I actually, whether it has to do with target panic or not, but I will tell you, after that happened to me, every time I was at full draw, man, I was always worried I was going to do that again.
Yeah, so. I did it actually at the staff meeting the other week. Well, unfortunately, my string loop came untied because I was not the best bow technician when I installed it. I even looked at it the night before, and I was like, I wonder if that's going to hold. And I was like, yeah, there's only one way to find out. So if you find an arrow, out in a field somewhere at the hunt club.
Nice.
And it looks like mine.
It's going to be my tractor tire for $1,200.
Possibly. Well, in that case, it's not mine. So, guys, the last segment we've got for this week is Tom Alford, who's given us a little bit of an update on his food plot. Obviously, with it being spring and going into summer, it's definitely food plot season. So let's check out what he's doing now.
All right, well, it is officially food plot season, and to be honest with you, I feel like I'm running a little late. It's May 20th, and you can see the old bean plots from last year aren't looking that great. I did not spray, but I'm gonna use Roundup Ready beans and corn in this particular plot, and we're just gonna rototill the crap out of it today. We're gonna plant it, and then we'll come in and spray it. I've determined that I want this spot to just be late season. It's a great late season spot. I've learned over the years with all the trail cameras that I'm running, the deer love it in here post November. And the plan is actually to get the deer to feel safe in this food plot so I can get the corn around the outside edge of the entire thing and then beans relatively close to that stand right there. I'm gonna have a tree stand right up there so I shouldn't have to take a shot that's further than 35 yards. All right, well, this is area number two. Behind me is my tree stand. I've got a awesome vantage point from that tree. It's one of the only trees around here. That's kind of why this whole food plot is designed. But this little lower field here, deer really like to feed in it. So I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm gonna mix the corn with the beans in here. I got a strip of the Heartland clover right there. And then beyond that is the Heartland clover chicory mix. All right, well, that didn't look like a whole lot, and it's really not, but it's just enough. And as I get closer to the stand, I leave those areas open so I don't have to shoot through a corn stalk. But once that's all rototilled in here, it'll be beans and then sporadic corn here and there. All right, well, here's a little different view. This is the fourth field. Same idea, corn, beans, scattered all throughout here. I really want to force the deer to the Heartland plot. It's got all the clover and chicory back there. The one tree stand I can hunt over here on this side for a southwest wind. It's amazing, so hopefully they gravitate this way. And then, if you turn around and look back this way, same idea. I've got all the corn, beans, everything throughout here, and then that's my other Heartland plot over there in the corner, and I got a tree stand right over there. It actually worked perfect. The deer followed the clover line, and they spent a ton of time this winter on this little high spot. I got lots of pictures of deer in the snow feeding on there, so they love it, and I can still shoot to it from that tree stand, so it's looking really good.
All right, well, Jack and I are back at the farm where we planted all those food plots a couple weeks ago. Today's June 12th. We are gonna get set. We're gonna run the sprayer back there because I'm sure there's a few weeds popping up. Check the overall health of the plots and grab all our trail camera cards, and hopefully we got a few deer on there. So here we go. Bowhunt or die. All right, well, this is the plot number one. This is the plot that I figured was gonna have trouble. There was a lot of weeds in here, and as you can see, looks kind of wimpy, but that's all right. We're just gonna keep spraying it. I mean, there's not a lot of soybeans in here, but there's enough, and it's better just to keep the weeds out of it. So worst case scenario, if this thing does not work out, we'll come in with brassicas in August and just broadcast them all through here, because you know, by keeping it clean, then at least you'll have good soil contact with the new brassicas if the beans don't turn out. So I'm just gonna go ahead and spray this anyway and start knocking these down. All right, well, as I was driving around spraying, kind of looking through here, there's a bunch of stuff going on. One, it looks like I missed some areas with seed. Two, the deer are eating the tops right off the beans. And three, it was an experimental plot and it didn't work well. All right, well, this plot's actually looking really good here. Combination of beans and corn. I can see corn popping up all throughout here, which is exactly what I wanted. I wanted that corn to grow up and kind of give the beans a little more cover and let the deer feel comfortable feeding in here. But the beans look really good. I mean, some of them are eaten down, but it's looking really good. I mean, you can see up there that field. It's awesome looking. So, good news. All right, well, this is plot number three. Looks pretty good as well. Good mixture of corn and beans, and really no weeds in this one, so we did a good job spraying it. We got a trail camera right here. We're gonna check and see if we got any good ones in here. All right, well, you know what? The first check on the food plots went all right. The overall health of the food plots are okay. They're not as good as I had hoped. So, with that being said, what we're going to do is just continue to keep the soil clean and continue to keep spraying it with Roundup. We'll let the beans and the corn grow up, and we're probably going to end up with some bald spot areas. So we'll go in with brassicas. Typically, I use the Heartland turnip mix. We'll sprinkle a little bit of winter wheat in there and even oats, but we'll just go through and we'll just keep planting as much food throughout the year, and hopefully by October 1st, we've got a number of different things that the deer are in here eating. So, till then, bow hunt or die, baby.
You know, guys, each year we talk about food plots and what you can do to kind of enhance the different properties, you know, that you have. Tommy's obviously putting together some different smorgasbord opportunities to enhance his hunting. And, you know, Justin, I know you've got a couple small plots that you work on. I've always got some plots that I work on. And, you know, the number one thing that I tell people every single year is really just slow down and have a plan before you get to the piece of property that you're going to. I mean, too many times we're just in a rush with these food plots and then you don't get the results that you want. So again, slow down, have your plan, know what you're going to plant, and really just think about each stage of that food plot's life of what it's going to require for you in order to get the best results.
So. Sure, and don't use food plots as a substitute for figuring out how to hunt. You know, no. All too many times I think guys go out and they plant food plots and they just think that like the only thing they have to do is plant a food plot and the deer are just going to come to it, and they give no thought to, you know, what time of year they're going to hunt it, what wind direction they're going to hunt it, you know, how they're going to get in, how they're going to get out, if it's near bedding or it's not near bedding, and they end up putting a food plot and they don't get the results out of it right. That they want to see, and then they're like, well, I'm never putting a food plot in again because that didn't work. I mean, it's not a bait station. It's not a pile of corn that they're going to come to. I mean, you have to put some additional thought, you know, ultimately into doing that. So guys, that's all the, you know, the footage and action we've got for this week's show. Of course, you know, before we leave, we want to take just a couple seconds to thank some of the people that sent in their trophy photos for this week's show.
Jason Hunt.
Weston Merkins.
The Olsen Brothers.
Ryan Bothdorf.
Dylan Defferding. Congratulations, guys. Those are some great trophies. If you'd like to see yourself right here on an episode of Bowhunt or Die, remember, send them to us through Facebook, or of course, you can always visit our website at bowhunting.com and upload your own trophy photo so you will see yourself right here on an episode. Justin.
Yes, sir.
Here we are. I mean, we are pushing into July. Antlers are finally starting to really show you what you have or what you don't have.
Yeah.
How many cameras you got out? Come on. How many?
Two.
Two. Oh my gosh, that's horrible.
Well, July 4th is usually my go period for putting cameras out. I mean, I have a couple that have been out for a few months, but you know, ultimately, I mean, the racks aren't really doing a whole lot until July. So this is when I'm going to start getting cameras out after this weekend.
I agree. I agree. I've only got about three or four cameras out, so I can't.
Oh, so you're giving me a hard time.
That's what we always do. Nice. We give each other a hard time. I only got about three or four cameras out too, but there's no question about it. Right now, moving forward, it's it. You know, the weeds are about as high as they're going to get. You know, a good machete, chopping them down, getting them positioned is definitely, this is it.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, by the time we film the next show, I'll probably have a dozen cameras out in the woods. So, you know, hopefully we'll have some great hit list updates coming for you guys pretty soon. I know some of the guys with cellular cameras like Troy are always texting me pictures of bucks, you know, in his food plot 2 hours away that he's getting.
Oh, nice,
you know.
Troy. I never got it.
He doesn't text him, do you? Well, you... You never respond to anybody. So, that's guys, that is all the action we've got for this episode of Bow Hunter Die. We'll see you again in 2 weeks with some more great bow hunting action.
For more exciting action, be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram and receive live updates from our team members as well as the latest happenings in the bow hunting and archery world. Be sure to share your photos, stories, and experiences as well. And don't forget to pick up your official Bowhunting.com and Bowhunter Die gear by visiting Bowhunting.com/gear. We have a full selection of hats, shirts, decals, wristbands, and much more.
Stella will take care of the fertilizing. Here we go.
We're in the zone now.
How are we zoning?
I don't think you can ever like put yourself in the zone. You just kind of get there, you know?
Yeah.
Otherwise, you just
you're either there or not.
Otherwise, you'd just be in the zone all the time.
That shirt is ridiculous.